Good morning. It's Tom Padula from Tom Padula TV and Insegna Booksellers. And this morning I'm presenting another presentation on lesson, if you like, on Africa. Because we are up to presentation 23, and it's important to remember that we began our journey from the very beginning of the historical period, from the Big Bang Theory. We are now in the last phase of looking at the last continent, if you like, which should really be the first continent, Africa. Because Africa is, hello Curtis, welcome, and thank you for coming on. Africa is an incredible place, and really it deserves a lot of attention on our part, because that's where the first hominids began. Welcome to Assunta Lombardi. The hominids began. Now, before I go any further, I've been thinking about, let's have a look at Africa, the way it is today, and let's get an idea of what happens. But I won't start that until we actually get to 11:30. That was a thought. And then the other thought, that looking ahead, say, what am I going to do now? This is a journey, an historical journey. I've done, the five old continents, really, including the North Pole and the South Pole. And we know that in the South Pole, there was hardly any human life for a long time, until the last couple hundred years, where the discoveries were made, where people were brave enough to go down. But in the North Pole, the Eskimo people and all other peoples in the northern regions, they've managed to survive over the centuries. And that's good. Then we looked at the Middle East, from Egypt going to towards the Euphrates and the Tigris rivers, and then the Indus Valley, China, and the northern part of Asia. And then, of course, we touched on the Americas and the middle, Southern America, South America, and Central America. Therefore, there was one continent that was left. It was Africa. And I was wondering why, this happens. It's because in educational circles, we don't give much attention to Africa. That's what I think. And therefore, this world history idea is a good one for us humans to remember. And the current conflict that we have emanating from Russia is an interesting one, because a lot of that has happened in the past. It's an old-fashioned type of war. We don't want wars anymore in the world. We want a humanity that is close together and respects the value of the land and the skies, which we all own, regardless of where we are in the world. Nationalism is it should be just for administrative purposes, not because people are playing with power with it. You're not going to take it with you. So how long can it takes so long to build things up. Are you going to smash them? The administration of the world is very complex, because today we're trying to feed everybody, house everybody, give health to everyone. Then all at once you get this guy start throwing missiles. Well, I honestly didn't think that he had it in him. I was wrong. There are reasons why people do what they do, but when you resort to violence, it's no good. It's better, we have another problem here with floods, all those people needing help. The armies can have to do that sort of work. And all the armies of the world in their own region and their own areas, they need to do that. And if you travel between to and fro each country, it doesn't matter who really runs it. I think there should be a period of time in which people run anything and then they should go away and let other people take over. In the mess that it creates is the best option, because when you give people too much power, maybe it goes to their head. Power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Yep, that's it. So after this, I'm going to also do before the invasion, and we're going to look at the bone and shell tools, bone, because we did the stone tools last week, bone shell, and then I'll do something from Benjo Patterson, and of course then I'll do the Italian songs. I love that. That's a good, nice part, even though it's an history part, gives me, and maybe you, something to talk about. Anyway, this 11:30, welcome to both Curtis and Assunta, and here we go. All right, so let's have a look. Believe it or not, I was trying to get this particular map, you know, in hard copy, but my printer, I tried everything. I couldn't get it out. Anyway, never mind. Well, have a look. The middle part of Africa there, look at how many states there are. We don't talk about the states, do we? We talk about each nation. And all these places, you know, they say that the southern part, say from Ethiopia, Sudan, Chad, Niger, Mali, Mauritania, and down, they didn't have a Bronze Age, which Egypt had. They had an Iron Age, so the Bronze Age, they never came down. Most of the southern part, right, Democratic Republic of Congo, there, Tanzania and Kenya, and on the other side, Congo Republic. These areas here remained practically the way they were in Neolithic times, later Neolithic times, where people had moved further down. You know, they established pastoralists. You know, they domesticated the animals, and they continued to trade in those forever. A lot of the animals still today, but again, you know, I haven't travelled to Africa. I don't know you, but people, you know, there are a lot of good documentaries on it, showing the old type of Africa, the cultures of Africa. So, but this continent deserves a lot more attention, historically speaking, and the archaeologists today are doing a good job. They're doing a good job. So that's Africa for you. Look how many states there are. Very small, very large. And, you know, we don't get much, we don't get much that is uplifting about Africa in the media. It's a real pity. But anyway, I think we should know more about it, and I will come back. But from next week, I'm going back I'm starting again, let's say, from the Hittites, from the Iron Age, up to, we're going to cover 1500 to 1000 to 100 to when, you know, the Roman, to Caesar, to the birth of Christ, if you like, all that area. And I'll go right through. Then we'll look at the various civilizations and how they developed, and how it was developed for in Europe, and how things moved on. But I will not neglect the other, let me go back now. I will not neglect the other continents. So we're going to go back into the various continents again and looking at them closely, you know, with more modern times when their civilization developed. I was looking at a documentary about the Maya Empire, and they said that the Maya in Central America at one stage controlled up to 15 million people. 15 million people. And then this guy called Christopher Columbus, and I was very proud of him, and I still am, born in Genova, Italy, and served the Queen and King of Spain, and went to discover America for them. In other words, went to the other lands in order to find trade and exploit those people there, basically. So let's think about the invasions. It's part of human life. You know, governments in all ages have always had this desire to have more trade and more wealth for themselves. It's a good thing, but let's explain it now for what it is. And let's look at history in a slightly different way. We want to avoid the mistakes of the past. And I think Putin is making a mistake for himself too. Because a lot of the Russian people, I'm sure, they don't want wars. They want peace. People want to travel between countries. People want to work in each other's countries. People want to, why all this? But then the power of the state. You got an army at your fingertips if you're a leader. No one can compete against that sort of a personality when the laws of the land state that whatever that person says or does, or whatever parliament it is, doesn't have to be necessarily the dictatorship, can be a democracy. We've had it here in Victoria. Last couple of years, we've had a lot of restrictions placed on us. And, you know, if you didn't do what, apart from the advantages of those restrictions, but if you didn't do what was necessary, that the government thought was necessary for health reasons, you got punished. You were fined. And if you protested, you were fined again. You know, it wasn't a pleasant thing. So, how are we going to look at this history and how are we going to learn from it? Well, basically, I urge you now to take it on and start with Africa. So, there was just so much of it that I thought, no, I'm not going to. I'll just do a little bit of it today. Metal use in Africa. Farming societies in Africa developed after the origins and spread of livestock pastoralism throughout the continent. The early use of metallurgy by farming communities may have been developed independently in Africa around 3000, 2000 before the birth of Christ. So around when the Hittites, well, they sort of arrived later because, you know, in... next week we're going to go back to the Hittites. It's about 1500 when the Iron Age began to take hold. But it didn't, you know, straight away. So pockets of iron usage appeared in subsequent millennia, but metal did not supplant stone in the south of the continent until around 500 BC. When both iron and copper spread southwards through the continent, reaching the Cape around 200 C. So around 200 before the birth of Christ, you get the bronze and the iron coming south. I mean, there was always trade. It's always trade in these places. People moving all the time. Part of human history, the movements. Now, the 5 million people that are reputed to be going out of Ukraine, they've got to go somewhere else, don't they? So it's going to be, you know, a new world for them and for the people who receive them. It's done under duress. no good. It's better to sort things out in peace. But anyway, let's go on. Although some details regarding the Bantu expansion are still controversial amongst archaeologists, linguists and historians, the widespread use of iron does seem to have played a major role in the spread of Bantu farming communities throughout sub-Saharan Africa. Contact and interaction between hunter-gatherer, pastoralists and incoming farming communities remains an important topic of interest in African archaeologists today. So when these types of organisations come together, they all begin to learn from each other. Now, this is what's happening now in modern times. In 2014, ancient DNA analysis of 2,330-year-old male foragers' skeleton in southern Africa found that the specimen belonged to the LODZ, or whatever, you know, the blood types. This maternal clade is today most closely associated with the Jew, a subgroup of the indigenous Sun people, which points to a population continuity in the region. So people want to know, how long have you been here? How long have you lived in here? In 2016, a late Iron Age desiccated mummy from the Thuli region in northern Botswana, it was also found to belong to haplogroup LO, again, blood types. In central Nigeria, West Africa, around 1500 BC, the Nok culture developed in the Jos Plateau, on the Jos Plateau. Again, you know, you got to know these things. These are all details that I'm not really aware of. So you're reading and, you know, they give you these names, but, you know, if you want to go really close, then you have to go to the maps. You've got to find out. Interesting. The Nok people produced lifelike representations in terracotta, including human heads and human figures, elephants and other animals. By 500 BC and possibly a few centuries earlier, they were smelting iron. By 200 AD, the Nok culture had vanished. So do these cultures last? A lot of them don't. A lot of them don't. They disappear after a few years. Based on stylistic similarities with the Nok terracottas, the bronze figurines of the Yoruba kingdom of Ife and those of the Bini kingdom of Benin are now believed to be continuations of the traditions of the earlier Nok cultures. So when the cultures faded away, when the people went somewhere else, they, you know, they brought with them what they knew and they continued. A bit like our migrants, you know, Italian background, so what you bring here, you know, the people brought my parents, you know, people before them, they brought in the food and the various, ciao Antonio Danzi, thank you for coming on. You know, these are always about human movement. Okay, so that's the Nok culture, N-O-K. Now you can look it up. Historical Africa, now this last bit here, let's have a look. Trade with the Near East and Europe led to strong mercantile empires growing such as the Ethiopian Kingdom of Aksum. That's a nice one. Ethiopian Kingdom of Aksum. Look up the history of Ethiopia. Various states and polities also developed in West Africa, including Ife, I-F-E. The Kingdom of Benin, another one. Igbo, Ukwu, I-G-B-O, Ukwu, U-K-W-U. The Jene, Denjo, Jeno, D-J-E-N-N-E, with an accent, dash, D-J-E-N-N-O. Ghana Empire. These are all old empires of Africa. Bona State and the Ashanti Empire. I've heard of the Ashanti people. I've heard of Benin, you know, sort of When I was reading about the, I must confess, I was reading about the slave trade in America, and Kyle Onstott and what's his name? The other writer, Lance Horner. They wrote something like 25, 30 books about it. I read them all. And they were talking about the Ashanti people. Tall people. Interesting. The Bantu, I've heard of those too. Bantu peoples in southern Africa built the impressive site of Great Zimbabwe between the 10th and 15th century CE after Christ. The north of the continent had close cultural and economic ties with the classical and medieval Mediterranean. Cattle herding became important in the Horn of Africa, and huge earthwork enclosures were built to corral the animals. The people of the Christian Ethiopia produced impressive rock-cut monolithic churches, such as that of St. George at Lalibela, during the 13th century, and the first Portuguese forts appeared soon after this, penetrating as far south as Zambia. So the Portuguese, they sort of went into Africa in a big way. And they say that, you know, up to that time, up to the colonization of the south of the Sahara, the people there remained, lived the way they had lived for centuries, for millennia. That's why, you know, the next progress is when the English went down. And we've got quite a bit of history about the English in Africa. Of course, let's not forget the French, big colonizers of Africa. So they all dabble, you know, the colonizers. Everyone talks about the bad things that the colonizers did, but the reality is that the colonizers brought the modern world of their times to these well-established Neolithic villages. It's a pity because they get destroyed, but not fully. It's always integrated into, you know, the people come in. Yes, they invite, but also they bring in something with them. And if it blends well, then it's a good thing. I'm more in favour of migration. In fact, I'm all in favour of the world being a lot more free for everyone. But then, you know, some people say, but then there are abuses, so there is this, there's crime. That's the problem. That's why peace, we should have peace within us, so that we don't want to have wars with other people. And what do we do? Now, you know, there's a war in Ukraine now, and they have to defend themselves, or people can give them arms. How good is that, huh? War will bring in other wars. It's a hard one. This is history thing is, on reflection, is a very, very difficult area of study, and that's probably gets ignored a lot. Okay, now I've got a quarter of an hour more, and what, you know, the question is, what have we learned from going around the world? What do we learn? Does it make us more peaceful? Come on, you know, you start thinking yourselves, what has Tom tried to do over the last 23 lessons, presentations? What have I tried to do? Apart from the actual details that I bring to the table, then I talk quite a bit about it, you know, how does it relate to today's life. How does this... So we need a certain amount of knowledge, but we don't need all the knowledge straight away. We need knowledge to bring us to the next stage. Can't do it all in one day. But what we can do is we can revise. We can revise. So what are we supposed to revise here? Well, my challenge to you is go back to Egypt. Have you seen, ask yourself, have I done something that would please Tom, knowing that I have watched documentaries and I watched this and that, or I've read about ancient Egypt, about the, the rise of the Hittites soon, but what about Sumer and the Tigris River? That was a nice big civilization too. Have you seen many films about that? Not many. What about the Indus Valley? Never hear about it, do we? But it's there. So why don't people talk about it? Or maybe they do, but I don't know. And you probably don't know either. So let's find out if, in fact, we are wrong. If we are wrong, it's a good thing. Because those civilizations actually existed and they needed to be appreciated. But the people who live within those walls, within the same lands that the ancient people lived, they have special ties to those lands. So that's good. That's good. Then we went from there to China. Now, China is really, I've said this before, up to 200 years ago, the Europeans had great admiration for China. It was an exotic place, a place where, and people talked very well about it. Why did they talk well about it? Because they didn't have much to do with them. And when they did, they, started to discover some of the problems that these people had, but also some of the advantages. And that's, the progress. Progress comes about around that time. Then I thought we'd go further north and look at the northern part, the northern lands, Siberia, Sweden, Norway, Finland, those areas there, and what happened there. We get about the Vikings, and then I'm going to get my TV soon with Netflix. I'll be able to watch some of those Viking series. Lots of beautiful material that's out there today in cyberland and also, in libraries. If you're interested, get a few books, have a look at the various cultures of the world. So we went from there, and I think we digressed into South America, Central America, and North America. Now, they were very interesting. A very interesting part, because there's a lot of conflict in those lands from the beginning of the white settler. Yep. So that's it. That's basically, I'm done with this part of history. The only other thing that I want to mention is that really, have a look at the Maya, Aztecs and the Incas. If you can look some documentaries, especially the Maya, because they were just as big as the Roman Empire. And then it disappeared. And then it's only recently that, you know, there are excavations, someone dedicated 20 years of his life to uncovering the, you know, the archaeological sites of this beautiful civilization. A lot of the food that we know, corn and potatoes, and they came from those places as well. Corn especially, they is reputed to have been created there by the Maya. Not bad. A good source of, you know, food. Very good source of food. All right, well, that's it. So basically, then if you really want to, go down to Brazil and Argentina, have a look at, I always thought, you know, the expeditions of Mawson in Antarctica, interesting parts, and that's why you can sort of blend all this together. All right, so now next week I will be going back to the Iron Age, the Hittites, and there'll be more organization because they're actual, you know, textbooks relating to this. It makes my life a lot easier when I explain it. Because then, you know, through reading, you get that. Okay, so basically that's it. Now let's go to before the invasion. But before bone and shell tools of the Aboriginal people, and what do they use? Bone tools were used all over Australia as spear tips, fish gorges, harpoon heads, pegs for spear throwers, and as death pointers or deadly weapons. A small sharp bone was used for flaking the edge of a stone knife or point. I showed you last week, Crocodile Dundee's his big knife. It's, you know, that's as big as these knives were, made of shell. In the southeast, fine awls, AWLS, it's pricking tools, and needles made from the leg bone of an emu or kangaroo were pointed by careful rubbing on the surface of a stone. They were used to pierce skins, which were then sewn together for cloaks or rugs by poking thin strips of leather through the holes. Animated teeth were useful. Animal teeth were useful, especially if they were still on the jaw, which could be used as a handle. Interesting. Kangaroo, wallaby and dingo teeth were used to etch designs on wooden objects. So they had pretty, you know, very special uses for these tools. At the seacoast and along the rivers, shells were useful. On islands off the North Queensland coast, shells were chipped into shape and then sharpened by grinding. They could be used to slice and scrape edible roots like yams and as knives and fish hooks. Women's tools and possessions. In every area of Australia, the woman's chief tool was her digging stick. This was made of hardwood. It was from 1 meter to 1.5 meters long, that the digging stick, and pointed at one or both ends. Women used this to dig out edible roots and burrowing creatures, such as wombats, bandicoots, and lizards. It also came in as handy as a club to kill them. So they could actually kill the animal as well. Well, each woman also had one or more carrying dishes made of wood or bark. And a net, bag or basket too. She often carried a wooden dish or a bundle of firewood on her head and had a donut-shaped pad, often made of human hair, to cushion and steady the load. So they put human hair on top of their heads. I remember them. Like their husbands, women often used stone tools, but mostly did not own many of those. Among the Hurons of Cape York, men owned all the stones, axes, which had to be obtained by trade and were greatly valued. A woman had to borrow one when she needed it, so she borrowed it. Women, just as much as men, were able to use whatever they could find. For example, if a woman did not own and carry a well-made stone knife, she could use a heavy stone to hit a sharp flake off another stone when she needed a cutting tool. Women did most of the spinning into string of human hair, animal fur, and plant fibres. And a woman might carry in her dilly bag a supply of these raw materials. So there you are. Even human hair was used. It reminds me of another war of another type, when they would kill the people and keep their hair, which she would work on in her spare time. Or she might carry a supply of string already spun for the bag or basket she was making. All human hair and beard trimmings found their way into the same woman's dilly bag. So convince her husband to cut his hair and keep the hair. In the southeast, southwest, and in Tasmania, women also owned a fine bone owl to make two holes in schools. In the southeast, southwest, and in Tasmania, women also owned a fine bone awl to make holes in skins for cloaks, and they probably had a stone scraper with sharp shell for cleaning flesh off the skins. Most important for women's work were grinding stones, which were used for preparing vegetable food. Mostly these were left at often used campsites for anyone who camped there. There you are, a nice one, huh? Sharing is caring. They were too heavy to carry, but a woman might carry an upper grinding stone, which was much smaller than the bottom one. Okay, so that's it. Should I show you this? No, it's all right. A woman carrying a wooden dish. Hey, I'll show you. There you are. That's how they were. Carry one of those on your head. Do you get a neck ache? That's the question. Oh, well. So that's that. Now, I'm not going to do any more. There's also tools in use. Oh, we might just do this one here. Okay, tools he used. Here is an example of how wood, bone, and stone tools were used in making the possum skin cloaks worn in Victoria and other places. Each skin was stretched on a piece of bark cut from a tree with a stone axe. Wooden pegs, again made with a stone axe, were used to hold the skin onto the bark. When it was quite dry, it was scraped with a mussel shell or a sharp stone flake. Hello, Angela. Welcome. Before sewing the skins together, holes were made along the edges with a fine bone point made of an animal bone and sharpened on a rough stone. The sinews from the tail of a kangaroo were poked through the holes. And finally, the inside of the skin was decorated with slanting lines. This was done with a stone flake or the incisor tooth of an animal, still attached to the jawbone, which acted as a handle. So these fine cuts all over the skin also made it bend or fold more easily. So well, that's it for today. Next time it says, how to make your boomerang. That'll be interesting. Okay, well, that's it for before the invasion. You know, it's nice to have the resources. You know, you don't have to think too hard. But I probably will start writing some articles about it because you need to bring the whole thing together. World history, huh? And then we got the colonisers, you know, and amongst the colonisers was Banjo Patterson. That was after the invasion, about 1890. By the Grave Gulf Water is a nice poem. Not too long, but here we go. Far to the northward there lies a land, a wonderful land that the winds blow over. And none may fathom nor understand the charm it folds for the restless rover. A great grey chaos, a land half made, and the soul of a man will recoil afraid from the sphinx-like visage that nature was wearing. But old Dame Nature, though scornful, craves her dole of death and her share of slaughter. Men indeed are the nameless graves where her victims sleep by the grey gulf water. Slowly and slowly those grey streams glide, drifting along with a languid motion, lapping the reed beds on either side, wending their way to the northern ocean. Grey are the plains where the emus pass, silent and slow, with their staid demeanour. Over the dead men's graves the grass may be is waving a trifle greener. Down in the world where men toil and spin, Dame Nature smiles as man's hand has taught her. Only the dead men her smiles can win in the great long land by the great Gulf Water. Obviously, quite a few people died by the grey Gulf Water. For the strength of a man is an insect's strength in the face of that mighty plain and river. And the life of a man is a moment's length in the life of the stream that will run forever. As so it come to the day take no part in small world worries, each hardy rover rideth abroad and is light of heart, with the plains around and the blue sky over. And up in the heavens the brown lark sings the songs that the strange wild land has taught her. Full of thanksgiving, her sweet song rings, and I wish I were back by the grave gulf water. And I wish I were back by the grave gulf water. So maybe Banjo had been to the grave gulf water. I don't know where it is. Looks like it's the northern part of Australia. Anyway, that's enough for Banjo Patterson as well. And I asked, you know, do you look up books by Banjo Patterson and see if you can find any in the library. or amongst yourselves. In yourselves, you never know. You could have one of those. All right, now, well, I want to share my... I did a bit of singing on my own. I can't believe it. Oh, no, here it is. I've got to do it again. Never mind. Here we go. Yes, done. Ah, well, I'm always happy when I get to this stage. Today I wasn't in the best of, you know, in the best of moods for this, but, you know, a commitment is a commitment. And therefore, the show must go on, regardless. That's, you know, and I thought to myself, I sang this song here on my own a whilst back, and then I did it with Rino as well. So we're going to do Fiorin Fiorello a couple of times. Fiorin Fiorello l'amore. Let's go to this. Here. This is the song that we're doing. See? Fiorin Fiorello. Now, the advantage of this is that you can get the words eventually from me. Come and see me, and I'll give you the words. And then I'll show you now how to sing it on your own. Fiorin Fiorello is a lovely song. And here it is. Oggi tutto il cielo in festa, più ridente brilla il sole, e non so perché vedo intorno a me tutte rose e viole. Il mio cuore innamorato non lo posso più frenare, io non so cos'è, c'è qualcosa in me che mi fa cantare. Fiorin Fiorello, l'amore è bello vicino a te. Mi fa sognare, mi fa tremare, chissà perché. Fior di margherita, cos'è mai la vita se non c'è l'amore che il nostro cuore fa palpitar. Fior di verbena, se qualche pena l'amor ci dà, fa come il vento che in un momento poi passa e va. Ma quando tu sei con me, io son felice perché, Fiorin Fiorello, l'amore è bello vicino a te. It's a lovely song to learn. Go for it.
And then, here, it's the same one. There we are. This one is with Rino.
Oh, it's beautiful. Fiorin Fiorello here with Dora and Rino. And here we go. Fiorin Fiorello. Oggi tutto il cielo è in festa. Più ridente brilla il sole. E non so perché vedo intorno a me tutte rose e viole. Il mio cuore è innamorato. Non lo posso più frenare. Io non so cos'è. C'è qualcosa in me che mi fa cantare. Fiorello, l'amore è bello vicino a te. Mi fa sognare, mi fa tremare, chissà perché. Fior di margherita, cos'è mai la vita se non c'è l'amore che il nostro cuore fa palpitare. Fior di verbena, se qualche pena l'amor ci dà, fa come il vento che in un momento passa e va. Ma quando tu sei con me, io son felice perché, Fiorin Fiorello, l'amore è bello vicino a te.
Wow, that's another good one there. And then there's this one here that we do straight after, and that's another one that we love doing.
I have always loved mazurkas and the polkas and the tangos and lots of, you know, the old-time music, which is still very much used in Italian clubs today here in Melbourne. And one of the songs is called La Mazurka della Nonna. I don't think I've heard it anywhere, but I'm going to try it for you today. Here we go. Quando senti l'orchestrina, tra una danza americana, che strimpella una mazurka dall'aria paesana, pensi allora alla quadriglia d'un bel tempo che passò, quando usava la pariglia attaccata all'andò, quando non c'erano i tanghi e i foxtrot. Ah, la mazurka che ballava la mia nonna, con le trecce a penzoloni, con i mutandoni sotto la sua gonna. Quando mio nonno, per baciare la sua mano, non usava la scaletta ma la bicicletta fino al primo piano. I giovincelli di vent'anni o poco più, come eran belli, coi baffoni per l'un su. Alla mazurka d'un bel tempo assai lontano, quando prima di sposarsi stavano a guardarsi con le mani in mano. Or si balla la carioca, il sassofono rimbomba, ma mio nonno suona ancora il grammofono a tromba. Pensa in me con nostalgia all'antica gioventù, quando allora ogni Maria non era Mario, com'era bello quel tempo che fu. Alla mazurka che ballava la mia nonna, con le trecce a penzoloni e con i mutandoni sotto la sua gonna. Quando mio nonno, per baciare la sua mano, non usava la scaletta ma la bicicletta fino al primo piano. I giovincelli di vent'anni o poco più, come eran belli coi baffoni per l'insù. Alla mazurka d'un bel tempo assai lontano, quando prima di sposarsi stavano a guardarsi con le mani in mano.
Now, I promise you, I promise you this, that this song's here, La Mazurka della Nonna, if I can find it, there it is here. These are the words. Okay, now if you come on Sunday, the 20th of March, to Federazione Lucana at 3:30 p.m. till 5, I do Lingua e Cultura. We could do some singing together and you can have the words to these songs as well. So if you let me know that you're coming, I will prepare a little booklet for you for songs to learn from the ones that I keep on doing. But this time here, let's have a look what happened there with Rina. Here it is. That's the one here. Okay.
This is a beautiful song, La Mazurka della Nonna, but we're going to give it a great interpretation today. And here we go. La mazurka della nonna. Quando senti l'orchestrina, tra una danza americana che strimpella una mazurka dall'aria paesana, pensi allora alla quadriglia d'un bel tempo che passò, quando usava la pariglia attaccata all'andò, quando non c'erano i tanghi e i foxtrot. La mazurka che ballava la mia nonna, con le trecce a penzoloni e con i mutandoni sotto la sua gonna. Quando mio nonno, per baciare la sua mano, non usava la scaletta ma la bicicletta fino a pieno piano. I giovincelli di vent'anni o poco più, come erano belli coi baffoni per il su. Alla mazurka d'un bel tempo sei lontano, quando prima di sposarsi stavano a guardarsi con le mani in mano.
or si balla la carioca, il sassofono rimbomba, ma mio nonno suona ancora il grammofono a tromba. Pensa, ahimè, con nostalgia all'antica gioventù, quando allora ogni Maria non era Mariù. Com'era bello quel tempo che fu. Alla mazurka che ballava la mia nonna, con la freccia penzoloni, con il mutandon sotto la sua gonna. Quando mio nonno poi baciare la sua mano, non usava la scaletta ma la bicicletta, fino a piano piano. I giovincelli di vent'anni o poco più, come eran belli coi baffoni per in su. Alla mazurka d'un bel tempo assai lontano, quando prima di sposarsi stavano a guardarsi con le mani in mano.
Beautiful, eh? That's another one of those beautiful... here we go. Now, rather than... I'm going to continue now with entertaining you with Dora and Rina, because it's more fun just with the music in the middle. But over the last 6 months almost now, we've gotten to know each other quite well, and I want to meet some of the people that follow me. And Federazione Lucana has been very generous in giving me a space in which to meet. So let's hope that on the 20th of March we can at least have a dozen people coming over and enjoying the fun. Let's start something where, with books I've done on shelf online, and this one here you can say online and in the club. So that's online and in the club.
Well, this is a song that Dora and Rina played before, Il Tango della Capriera. We have also in a lot of the clubs they play this a lot, Il Tango, Tango. So here we go, Il Tango della Capriera. Se una chitarra suona, cantano mille capinere, hanno la chioma bruna, hanno la febbre in cor, chi va a cercare fortuna, ritroverà un amor. A mezzanotte va, l'ora del piacere, e nell'oscurità ognuno vuol godere, son baci di passione, l'amore non sa tacere, e questa la canzone di mille capinere. Il bandolero stanco scende la sierra misteriosa, sul suo cavallo bianco spicca la rampa di una rosa, quel fior di primavera vuol dire fedeltà, e alla sua capinera egli lo porterà. A mezzanotte va, l'ora del piacere, e nell'oscurità ognuno vuol godere. Son baci di passione, la mano non sa tacere, e questa è la canzone di mille capinere. Musica. Lasciando le miniere, forse li porterà dell'ora in un forziere, ma il cuore lascerà tra mille capinere.
on Tuesdays, I have the Italian classes, and one of the things that I will be doing this time here is talk about phonology. And with phonology, this, you know, you have to read the word, so it's pronunciation. Then you've got to get the intonation right, how you read the sentences, and then this interpretation. Well, this song here needs a lot of touching up because it too much. It requires a softer approach. So that when you're doing the work, you don't see it. But after a while, you look back and you say, well, how can I improve that? It's an important song. And it needs a bit of, you know, a bit of a touch-up. So we can do it again and again until we get it right, no? Yes. The other thing, too, that I want to mention is Dante Alighieri. I'm up to Canto 26, and this week, this coming Sunday, I'll be doing Ulysses, and it's a very famous hero of the past. A lot was written by him, by Virgil, and Dante gives that whole different interpretation of his voyage. In the end, Ulysses gets drowned. He drowns, basically, just before in the distance, there is a mountain, presumably that of purgatory and paradise, and he drowns with his men because he promised them that, you know, he promised them that they would be all right. Well, he didn't give them good counsel, did he? So, welcome to Maria Anna Cassino as well. Good. So we're going to listen to another song now by Dora and Rina and me. Which one is it?
Well, Il cuore è uno zingaro is one of Nicola Di Bari's famous songs, and we're going to try today with Dora. Let's go. Okay. Il cuore è uno zingaro. Fatto tardi e da notte, non mi tenere, lasciami giù. Mi disse non guardarmi negli occhi e mi lasciò cantando così. Che colpa ne ho, che cuore non si intorevo. Catene non ha, che cuore non si intorevo. Finché prenderò il prato più verde che c'è, raccoglierò le stelle su di sé, e si fermerà, chissà, e si fermerà, oh, oh. L'ho vista dopo l'anno. L'ho vista dopo l'anno, la casera. Stringevo, sapendo che il mio cuore batteva, batteva. Mi disse stiamo insieme stasera, che voglia di risponderle sì, ma senza mai guardarla negli occhi, io la lasciai cantando così. Che colpa ne ho, se il cuore non ti interessa. Catene non ha, che cuore non zingareva. Finché troverò il fato più verde che c'è, raccoglierà le stelle su di sé, e si fermerà, chissà, e si fermerà. La 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 la, la 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 la. Oh, And of course, I use these songs in the Italian classes. I analyze them, I take the words out. So these songs are providing me with a lot of scope in terms of their use. And the next step will be to actually have people interested in singing in Italian, learning the lyrics, and they take it away. So on the 20th of March, which is a Sunday, from 3:30 till 5, I have a meeting. I've organised a meeting at Federazione Lucana, 3 Cameron Street, Brunswick. I'll get there about 3:15. You can get there a little bit later. But by 3:30, I will start. And the first meeting, I don't know how many people are going to show up. But if people show up, of course, it's free of charge. You know, I just want your company. And other people might want your company too. And then La Cosa Nasce Cosa, Il Tempo La Governa. And the other one that I love is Se San Rose Fioriranno. So on that note, it's a good note. It's 12:30. And don't forget, tomorrow is my French and Spanish lesson. French, which I know, but never, you know, no contact with French people, very little, if not much at all. But, you know, I am a qualified French teacher. So time for me to get back to the roots. And Spanish I've never done before. So I'm going to learn how to read it, listen, speak, read and write. Now, the grammar part is done. I'm not going to touch the grammar. A first presentation is done in the lessons 1 to 20 in Italian grammar. Okay, so that's a basis for all the courses you're doing with other teachers. It's a good series to listen to initially, if you're an adult. It's really designed for adults. So it's an explanation, okay? So on that note, ciao, arrivederci, alla prossima, prossimo giovedì, che sarà lezione 24, next time. Ciao, ciao, Tom Padula, Tom Padula TV on YouTube and Insegna Booksellers. Bye.